Okay, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'd like to call the Planning Commission meeting of Monday, March 5th, 2012 to order. Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Present.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Here.
Joanne Morris. Monique Kermes.
Present.
Patricia Naumoff.
Here.
Monica Gonzalez.
Here.
Lenny Franciski.
Present.
Laredo Gonzalez.
Present.
And Richard Gillis.
Here.
Everybody please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first thing in order, we have two new members with us today. New Commissioner, Mr. Gonzalez and Mr. Gillis. They're on the end, if anybody has seen. Okay, next on the agenda, we have approval minutes from the meeting of Tuesday, February 21st, 2012. Can I motion to approve?
So moved, Mr. President.
Second?
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Joanne Morris. Monique Kermes.
Yes.
Patricia Naumoff.
Yes.
Monica Gonzalez.
Yes.
Lenny Franciski.
Yes.
Laredo Gonzalez.
Yes.
Richard Gillis.
Yes.
Okay. Next on the agenda is our city planners report. Mr. Morsro.
I'd like to welcome our new members. We've met. And this requires that our president stand for these meetings, and it's very difficult on his feet, but he hopes to do his best.
Yeah, I'm not too happy about this either, so.
Well,
I need a higher chair, that's what I need.
Humility has its place, but you are the president, and we want to welcome you. Ms. Morris may be here shortly, and we didn't want him to have to jump up and down in case Ms. Morris showed, and we'll leave her seat as it is for now, okay?
Okay.
There was one item that was to be here that didn't call for your decision as much as I wanted you to be notified of it. Tredebi is the successor corporation, a Spanish-based corporation, to Pollution Control Industries. They are proposing to build a small facility to house their electric work. We have here today Mr. Robert Vaughn. It should have been on your agenda. They had gotten certain materials to us, but I would like, with the president's permission, that they do a presentation. It's very brief. And it was also an opportunity, I talked to Brian, who was Brodner, if I'm not mistaken. Brodner, who is with the facility, who's lived in this area all his life, and after graduating from Bishop Knoll, went to Purdue University in West Lafayette. Had an internship with Pollution Control Industries, and now has spent about 12, 14 years with the corporation. So I thought it was an opportunity, not so much because of requiring a decision on your part, as much as informing you about one of the corporations in our city, and pollution control is terribly important. At one time, Pollution Control was proposing that they would burn all the Vietnamese Agent Orange, and mm-hmm. that didn't go over terribly well. In fact, it was then Congressman, the recent governor of Illinois, who was a congressman at that time, who was on his way to Denver, who fought that very hard because it also went through Illinois and through the Chicago metropolitan area. So if we could, I'd like to invite you, Mr. Vaughn, just to come forward to present this. We also have David Matthews, who's from our building department and who is an electrical inspector and who has some substantive knowledge in case you have any further questions.
Okay.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm with Tredebi Treatment and Recycling, formerly known as Pollution Control Industries. My name is Bob Vaughn. I've been there approximately 2 years. I am the Environmental Compliance Manager, formerly Tita Legrimis, Executive Vice President, would sometimes make an appearance, or Brian Bodner, who is the engineer. Trodebi purchased, as he stated, was a Spanish company, purchased the facility in 2008, and we formally changed the name in 2010, January 1st, to Trodebi Treatment and Recycling. We have two plants, one in East Chicago, and we have one in Millington, Tennessee. The one in East Chicago is the primary, the largest plant that we have. We employ approximately 240 individuals, with 90% of those being employed within or living within Lake County. Approximately 70% of those employees live within a 5-mile radius of the facility, incorporating Whiting, East Chicago, and Gary. What we're proposing to do is, if anybody's been by our facility on Kennedy Avenue, you'll see that flame up in the air. Mm-hmm. That's part of the process. That's part of the pollution control system for what's called our solids distillation system. We take some material waste and what would normally go for burning, incineration or something, we recover the usable solvents. Solvents, let's say like acetone, nail polish, or parts cleaner, washing solvent. But if it was saturated in a rag, that process, which is patented, removes the organics out of it into a gas phase and then condenses it down back into a liquid, and it's sold as a product. It's permitted by and overseen by the Indiana Department of Environmental Management. That process was started in 2006 and has been productively generating and recovering solvents, usable materials for that time. We're taking it down on March 19th for a maintenance shutdown, a routine maintenance shutdown, but it's gonna constitute a big change to the facility. We gotta do an upgrade, and part of that upgrade is we're going to put in some newer technology, some equipment that's gonna help us recondense some of those gases so we can recover even more solvents out of that and put it back, that chemical back into the market. Part of this process is we want to build a little, and I mean little, 10 by 12 little building where we can house what's called a switchgear, electrical switchgear. Think of your house like a disconnect to just turn something on and off, or maybe the forerunners like the fuse box. We're going to put it in a little concrete block building. And I'm appearing before today to explain to you that it's a little 10 by 12, and it's gonna be on a little concrete pad, and it's a little building there, and it's got a little roof to it.
We've already presented that to the building department.
Okay. And the one slight change is when we looked at the building code for, and I've worked with the fire department on a couple of issues, Mr. Henry, and Chief Inspector Henry Ventura comes and visits our site. I worked with them and they gave us some information. One of the slight changes that we're going to make to that building is, originally we had it designed for about 10 and a half feet tall. It's got like a little lean-to roof on the high side. In order to meet the code so everybody feels comfortable about it, we're going to reduce that building height, which is not a problem. But one of the allowances in there is if we pull it down to less than 10 feet, then it's not an issue for anybody. We can build it as it is and meet the code requirements. So that's the slight change that we're going to make to that building code. Any questions?
What is the address of this facility?
4343 Kennedy Avenue.
Just north of the main line of the CSX tracks.
Mm-hmm. Almost straight across. I mean, that's the best way I know. If you go east, and it's right over there on Kennedy Avenue. Mm-hmm. It's the white building.
Very attractive multicolored signs mm-hmm. that have been there since they changed the name.
It's got a mural on the side of it.
Right across from Praxair.
Pardon?
Praxair is right across the street from it.
Mm-hmm. The unit that's going to be modified is, if you go in there right across the tracks, we have the first drive-in where the trucks go in, where we receive them. The second one is the first employee parking lot. When you go past there, it's right to the right, and that's where you'll see it's called a flare, is what controls those emissions. It burns any fugitive organic constituents that might not be condensed. So part of that system is we have to take that unit down. It's in, there's some tanks there, and then behind that there's a, it's like a metal building, corrugated steel is what they call it. And we've got to take that apart and take the unit down. The unit will be down for approximately 4 to 6 weeks. 4 weeks would be real energetic. 6 weeks is what we're shooting for, possibly eight. During that time, the facility will maintain and run. There are no layoffs. You know, if somebody wants to take a little time off, they can take some time off. But other than that, there's no layoffs. We have plenty of work to do. Once we get back done, then it goes through a period of startup, like any type of equipment when you do a maintenance on it. Go through a mm-hmm. check, and then we start and run back again. The Indiana Department of Environmental Management has been apprised of the situation, and we've been in conversation with them. They're on board with it, so they have no issues. We talked to the fire department. They're aware of the situation. They don't have any issues.
Okay.
The permits are in order, right?
Correct. Yes, ma'am.
You said that you use a solids distillation for recovery?
Yes.
Is that correct? And you said you used it to get acetone?
Well, it's solvents.
Okay. What other, I was just wondering, you're shutting down so that you could recover more?
We're doing a maintenance of it, and we're putting a condenser in. What the condenser does, the best way to describe this is, anybody have a Weber grill or ever see a Weber grill when they're cooking it? If you have a Weber grill and you put the charcoal on, you light it up, and it's got the flame in there, and you put the top on it to cook your food, what happens to the flame? Goes out, right? So it's roasting that. The system roasts that. What it does is heats up the matter that goes in there, and solvents could be soaked into a rag. It'll heat it up, and then it liberates those gases. Those are air emissions. They go through there, and then to get them back down into a liquid, you got to condense them or cool them. And that's what part of the equipment that we're going to put in there is a new condenser to help pull more of the solvent stream out of the gas and condense it more into a liquid. We're also doing that, and part of that system is a rotating drum, and that drum rotates and the material goes in there, gets heated up. It's in an indirect flame, but it gets heated up, and that excites the gases and wants to liberate out of the material, the waste, and that's where that gas stream comes in and condenses down. So that's, we're gonna replace that steel drum.
So you're going to upgrade and put in new equipment, but the building itself is going to be basically for electrical?
Yes, for the switch gear.
Gear and everything?
Yeah, the new equipment, we're just going to put in a new drum. We're not replacing the new equipment. Gets into a regulatory language there, so I want to make sure that we're clear there, that we're, it's not doing what's called a major modification. To be perfectly honest, what we're doing is a replacing the drum. That total unit's worth about $6 million. We're replacing the upgrade and everything. It's going to be not quite $1 million. Enhancement. Okay. I will be back probably in May because we want to build another building, another activity there, to, you know, construct another building there to do some other functions. They do have some serious plans for this site, this facility, you know, for our upgrades and maintaining it. That's the Trudebi Group. So I, you know, lay that out there just to chew on there. You know, if anybody had rumors, they got another facility they're moving, that's not correct.
So, any upgrades to the safety?
In the systems, we have, in that area, we have the fire protection. Like I said, the fire department came out and looked at it. The fire protection, that whole unit, that whole area is under either the housing itself has got the fire protection, like the sprinkler system, or on the outside it's got sprinkler systems, and we use the foam system in the event there. It's called a gun, actuator and a gun.
Okay.
But those are all still good and sound systems. So in this particular activity, there won't be any upgrades to that. No, sir.
Okay. Mr. Matthews, you went to the site. Did they speak with the building department? And
In actuality, Sergeant Electric is in the process. My name is Dave Matthews. I'm with the East Chicago Building Department, electrical inspector with the city. Sergeant Electric is now applying for permits for this project.
For the electrical portions, Trudebi applied for the original permit for the building. So there's two phases. One is the electrical.
James Portalatin and I had met together with Brian Bodner. We mentioned about that part, about the building structure. And that's what's inside of it. David's now referring to the work of Sergeant Electric has to do with what's going inside the building.
Okay. So, Sergeant.
Basically, it's a service upgrade of the existing equipment into the new building. So they're basically going to encapsulate it so it's safer for the equipment, so the rain and the weather doesn't encroach on it.
Okay.
And it's a 1,200 amps service.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Any other questions or?
With this improvement, are you going to generate new, you're going to hire new people, or?
This particular one won't increase the level of employment. on this particular operation, this change. We're upgrading the equipment and, you know, just redoing some repairs to it. The other works in the plan, they may have an impact on it, but this particular one, no, sir. This would be like a routine maintenance on a car. You know, it's a little bit more extensive when you talk $1 million, but, you know.
Okay. Are there any other questions? No? Well, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Okay. Mr. Marshall?
I will have a chance to meet with Mr. Vaughn, Mr. Bodner, and other people, and we'll try to. We had not discussed the further improvements, Mr. Vaughn. Perhaps I have a chance to discuss those and get kind of a picture of the overall direction of the plan.
Sure.
But as I say, I don't think any action is required of the Plan Commission in regards to this building, but I did want it. I looked on it as an opportunity to make you more aware of the plant that was there, what it was doing, and what they were hoping to upgrade.
Right, because these are just upgrades, basically.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
The only other item on the agenda today is the part three of the Citizens Planner's Guide, which I think was in your agenda package. I have one that wastes paper that's a full 14 sheets of paper. You have one that's 7 pages by, thank you, by using the both sides of the paper. As I mentioned to you, this comes to us from the Indiana chapter of the American Planning Association. I have had time to look closely at it and would simply point out how it mentions the techniques for avoiding pitfalls and then expands on the tools for avoiding those pitfalls. I don't feel I need to read all of it to you. If any of you have any questions, it mentions how spending more group time up front working on the big picture helps a planning foundation, and how to avoid problems. Regular communication coordination. One of the things, for instance, it mentions down further that those who work with other units of government, such as Councilman Franceschi and Mr. Gillis, who works with the Park Board, to occasionally fill us in on their operations and how they view different plans, different operations coming within the city. So that kind of communication and coordination mentioned on page 2. The due process items that are on the bottom of that page, such as the timely notice, giving people the opportunity to be heard, as we try to do, to notice, and this even hits the Board of Zoning Appeals even more than we are. For instance, free lunches are always a problem, whether it be for planners or commissioners, when people who have projects before us want to take us to lunch. We have to be very careful with that, and even talking privately to people who have cases before us. That conduct strictly illegal for BZA members, for instance, and can be also a risk for plan commissioners. Conflicts of interest, how you can even manage to get a felony indictment through some of this work, which is not my position to scare, but at least we ought to be aware of these things because they can be problems for us. And then trying E and point E, I'm on page 3 now, trying to make decisions in a reasonable amount of time. Preparing findings, point F. I've noticed in the work of Duane how carefully he put together findings as the basis for the decisions that the commission would make. Keeping complete records. We had an inquiry and a request for information just this last week over one of the plants that was closed because of it being now a commercial area, and how it turned out that we were scared quite a bit, you know, what had gone on. But we found that the records were in good shape and that the person who was saying he knew nothing about the process had been at the public hearings, had asked questions at the public hearings, and had been of record in the public hearings. So our fear was not was not realized. It had been conducted according to due process, giving him notice of what was about to happen to his property, and also giving him an opportunity to speak to that. So these are the points of Chapter 3. Are there any questions now, or I must admit I gave an advance copy to one of the new commissioners so that he would not feel he was behind, that he'd have a chance to catch up with his neighbor.
So have our new commissioners, could anybody get them copies of the previous guides?
I will get those to them from Chapter 1. Chapter 2 I didn't hand out as yet because that deals with the BZA, and I thought I would kind of move on to one that directly dealt with the plan commissioners.
Okay.
So we have three members to get the Chapter 1 to.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Marshall. It's been very helpful going over this.
Any other questions?
No.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now we come to our segment of commissioner comments. Do any commissioners have any comments or? No? Going once, twice. Okay, public comments. Anybody like to make any public comments before the commission? Going once, twice, three. Okay, our next meeting is Monday, March 19th, 2012 at 4:30 p.m. There being no further business, can I entertain a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez?
Yes.
Israel Rodriguez?
Yes.
Joanne Morris? Monique Kermes?
Yes.
Patricia Namoff?
Yes.
Monica Gonzalez?
Yes.
Lenny Franciscus?
Yes.
Laredo Gonzalez?
Yes.
And Richard Gillis?
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you.